to go on now to the introduction of our distinguished guest lecturer. You've heard a little bit about him, but I'm going to invite Professor Funke Adeboye to formally introduce him. Professor Adeboye.
Chief Mrs. Ade.Ajayi, the Vice Chancellor of the University of Lagos, Professor Rahman Bello, and Principal Officers of the University, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please permit me to stand on existing protocol. It gives me great honor to introduce to you this morning our guest lecturer, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles. Sir Hilary received his higher education in the United Kingdom and graduated with a Bachelor of Arts Honours degree in Economic and Social History from Hull University in 1976, and a PhD from the same university in 1980. He started his academic career at the Modern Campus of the University of the West Indies in 1979 as a temporary assistant lecturer. 12 years later, at the age of 36, he became the youngest professor in the history of the university. Thereafter, he was principal and pro-vice chancellor of the University of the West Indies Cave Hill Campus, Barbados, for 13 years. He was appointed vice chancellor of the University of the West Indies on the 1st of May, 2015. Professor Sir Hilary has emerged as a distinguished university administrator, internationally reputed economic historian, and transformational leader in higher education. He has lectured extensively in Europe, Africa, Asia, and the Americas, and has published more than 10 academic books. He is an editor of the UNESCO General History of Africa series. He is also vice president of the International Task Force for the UNESCO Slave Route Project. He is a consultant for the UNESCO Cities for Peace Global Program, and in 2014, he was appointed by the Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Ban Ki-moon, to his inaugural United Nations Secretary General's Scientific Advisory Board on Sustainable Development. Sir Hilary is, in addition, a respected playwright and member of the theater community. 8 of his plays have been staged to popular acclaim. In the corporate community, his footprint is well established. He's a long-serving director of SearchCorp Financial Corporation and has served as a director of its principal subsidiaries, SearchCorp Jamaica Limited and SearchCorp Barbados Limited. He is a director of Cable and Wireless Barbados Limited and is chairman of the University of the West Indies Press. Ladies and gentlemen, the international recognition of Sir Beckles' achievement has been global. He has received numerous awards, including Honorary Doctor of Letters from Brock, Glasgow, and Hull. all in recognition of his major contribution to academic research on transatlantic slavery, popular culture, and sport. Sir Hilary was made a Commander Knight of St. Andrew's, Barbados's highest honor, in recognition of his distinguished service in the field of education and for his dedication to the furtherance of the art and sport, particularly cricket. On the 10th of April 2015, Sir Hilary was honored by the Borough of Brooklyn, New York, for extraordinary achievement, outstanding leadership, and his contribution to the community. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me as I welcome Professor Sir Hilary Beckles to the podium as he delivers the first Ade.Ajayi Memorial Lecture titled History and the Pan-African Nation.
Thank you, Madam Chair, for your gracious and generous introduction. His Excellency, Vice President of our Republic, and allow me, Vice President, to say that I am waiting for a green passport. Our distinguished Vice Chancellor, Professor Bellows, Mrs. Ajayi, Mama Ajayi, and her distinguished family, members of the diplomatic corps, my colleagues here at the University of Lagos, distinguished members of the academic community, representatives of government, members of the media, students, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I wish to begin by thanking our host for the beautiful music we heard this morning. And for the special selection, because some of those songs I remember from my childhood. And I was listening to those beautiful songs, as well as the poem by Professor King. I was thinking that the slave traders took us across the Atlantic away from our home and took us into a place where they thought they could break our spirits. And it was their intention to break our spirits. But they did not succeed, and we have sent back to Africa some beautiful music. And we have sent this music back home to let you know that we're okay. We're okay. I am honored to be invited to speak in celebration of Professor Ajayi and to make comments in respect of his enormous legacy, also to bring to all of you here this afternoon respect and love from your colleagues at the University of the West Indies. I wish also to celebrate and to honor this very noble and distinguished family and to say blessings to Mama Ajayi. And their beautiful children who have taken great care of me these past few days. It is an honor for me as Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies to reciprocate in this hospitality in celebration of the 30th anniversary of Vice Chancellor Ajayi's historic visit to my university. I was able to enter into the record of the visit of Professor and Mrs. Ajayi to the university center in Jamaica at the Mona campus. And what a wonderful occasion it was for our university to host them. It has been 30 years since that great visit. And to recognize also my personal debt for his intellectual scholarship, for the extraordinary work he has done in the development of the Ibadan School, and to suggest also that I might have followed in his template as a historian, a head of the history department, a vice chancellor, and a Pan-Africanist. And that is the model he has established for us all. As historians, we all know that this republic, Nigeria, is the largest source of our people in the Caribbean. That the majority of our people of African descent originated here in this culture, in this space, this civilization we now call Nigeria. I am from the island of Barbados, which was the first stop from Nigeria in the Caribbean. Barbados was the first slave society in the modern world. This was the island where Africans outnumbered Europeans and became the majority in any society in the Americas for the first time. As early as 1660, the Africans in Barbados, unlike any other place in the Americas, were in the majority. And Barbados was the island where the model of slave plantation economy was constructed and perfected. This was a place where it was demonstrated that you could convert human beings into units of property, define them as non-human, drive them to labor in the production of commodities, and to make a fortune from your investment. Barbados became known in the 17th century as the richest colony in the world on account of this extraordinary economic system that was constructed using enslaved African labor. I now live in Jamaica, which is the headquarters of the University of the West Indies. And you may very well know that we have campuses in Jamaica, in Barbados, and in Trinidad and Tobago. But our headquarters is in Jamaica. constructed as the sister campus of Ibadan in 1948. And like Ibadan, starting off as a college of the University of London, and then to evolve into an independent regional university. But Jamaica became the largest recipient of Nigerian peoples. Jamaica, therefore, is Nigeria's largest diaspora. And you only have to travel through the countryside of Jamaica to realize that you are transported back into Nigeria. There is only one part of the Americas where the farmers plant their yam with a stick. That is in Jamaica. They do not do that in any other place but Nigeria and Jamaica. Because that is how the culture was transported from one place to another. And I should say to you that we have to give our blessings to Usain Bolt and to wish him the best. Because when he broke the world record and he was asked what is the secret of his success, he said he was raised on a diet of Nigerian yam. And it is interesting to note that when you travel through the rural parts of Jamaica, you can very well understand why the Yorubas and the Igbos and why they all felt at home when they got there. They recognized the landscape. The landscape was very familiar to them. And they were able to retain their culture in that landscape. I should say to you, therefore, that you have a responsibility to claim Usain Bolt as one of your own. He is a descendant of the Nigerian migration. And it is unfortunate that we have not yet done the research to establish the cultural continuity where Usain Bolt can recognize his Nigerian roots and you can recognize your Jamaican son. But that research will be evolving in the years to come. You are all aware, of course, of the story of Equiano, the young Nigerian boy who was sold into slavery and arrived in Barbados, my home, at the age of 14, and was enslaved on the island of Barbados for a few years before he was taken elsewhere to evolve as one of the greatest men of the 18th century. But there are some other stories, and I will share two of these stories with you because they are so relevant to my university at this moment in time. The University of the West Indies, our three campuses, were all built on slave plantations. When the British government was acquiring the land to locate these plantations, these university campuses, they bought sugar plantation lands and converted those lands into university campuses. It is interesting, therefore, that institutions of enlightenment should emerge out of landscapes of darkness. And out of this darkness of slavery has now emerged campuses of enlightenment. On the Barbados campus, we were conducting a research project as part of the 50th anniversary of the campus, researching on the African enslaved Africans who worked on that land, who cultivated that land, who died on that land, that is now upon us. We came across a story in the archives of a 3-year-old child whose name was Paul, an Igbo child, who was sold into slavery in Barbados. Paul was purchased for 20 guineas in the Bridgetown Harbor. And he was purchased by a slave owner who also had his 3-year-old child, and he wanted a toy for his child. He soon recognized that Paul possessed a special intellect as a child. He taught himself to read and to write. Paul eventually became the bookkeeper for the plantation. On the eve of emancipation, the Anglican Church built a chapel on the plantation, all of which are now part of the campus. And they needed a sexton to perform the ceremonies of the chapel and to conduct Sunday school for the children. Quar became the first black sexton of the Anglican Church anywhere in the world. He was distinguished for his Sunday school teaching, and therefore Quar became the first teacher on the land that is now the university campus. We have erected a monument in honor of Quar, the first teacher of our university campus space. We have his testimony. He died as a young man of color in the 1854 cholera outbreak. He died. But on his dying bed, he gave his testimony. Spoke of the loss of his family. He was married, he had 4 daughters, and he said on his dying bed, "I lost my family back home, but I now have a new family. I have rebuilt myself, I have reconstructed myself, and now I am a man of letters." These are interesting stories that emerge out of our campus land space. 3 years ago at the Mona campus in Jamaica, we took a decision to construct a state-of-the-art modern medical faculty. Our university started its journey 68 years ago with Abadan as a school of medicine. And so we thought it appropriate to give our ancestral faculty a beautiful, modern, state-of-the-art facility. The bulldozers came in to dig up the foundation. And suddenly, we are seeing bones emerging from the ground. We were able to stop the construction and to bring in our archaeologists, who were then able to identify that this was the burial ground of the Africans on the plantation. And hundreds of bodies of bones were taken from the ground, suggesting to us that our ancestors are alive and speaking to us. The university was placed in an interesting situation to take this living circumstance and to construct the narrative of what is the purpose of a university in the journey of the people. We were able to carry out the appropriate ceremonies, return those bones to the ground, to build a monument in honor of those ancestors. And we know from the burial goods that were placed in the ground with these bodies, many of them were Yoruba. Some of them were Igbo, some were Ga and Fandi of the locals. So Africa came up to us as we were looking to the future. The past spoke. Our responsibility now then is to construct a philosophy from the message that has come to us from the ground. This is not a lecture, therefore, this is the conversation I wish to have with my friends in Nigeria from the Caribbean. Much of this history is not captured in our writings, though it exists in our archives. And as I have told you, it is emerging from the ground all around us. Professor Ajayi's project was always to follow the people on their journey out of Africa over the Caribbean space. And this is why he came to spend time with us in the Caribbean, to let us know that when these Africans, these Nigerians, when they traveled from the coast, they did not travel away from their history. When they stepped off the motherland, they did not step off and out of their history. They were merely transporting their history to another place to begin again and again. This is why, when I was asked to prepare a critique of the 8 volumes of the General History of Africa, my critique began with a celebration of the extraordinary work done by African historians, many of them inspired by Professor Ajayi. But to say that these remarkable monuments, 8 volumes, are now insufficient. Because what they do not do is to capture the history of Africans outside of Africa. And therefore, the next 3 volumes of the General History of Africa must begin by following the Africans everywhere in the world they're in. Africans migrated and were taken to the Caribbean the Americas, to Asia, the Middle East. Africans were taken and migrated all over the world. And in these volumes, we are going to track down the history of African people in every part of this planet. And we are going to present three volumes under the title Global Africa 1, Global Africa 2, and Global Africa 3. There are many communities in the Caribbean that are still speaking Yoruba. Orisha is the fastest growing religion in the Caribbean. These are very important and significant developments. My message here, therefore, is this. Nigeria is the motherland and must therefore behave like a mother. Mothers do not turn their backs on their children. They might weep, they might suffer remorse, but they take ownership. Nigerian politics, Nigerian economics, foreign policy, civil society, academic discourse, therefore, need to take a step up in accepting this responsibility for the citizens who have migrated elsewhere. Nigeria is the largest civilization that has shaped the African community in the Caribbean. This legacy should not be seen as one of disconnection, but one of spiritual bonding. There are many Nigerian professors in my university. In fact, the dean of my home faculty, Humanities and Education, Professor Wari Boko, is from Nigeria. We teach African literature, and I had the pleasure some 10 years ago to go down to Enugu to spend a weekend with Chinua Achebe, my hero, my intellectual hero. We teach African history, we teach African philosophy, we teach African linguistics, we teach African archaeology. But what we do not have is an institute for African studies. Our strategy now is to bring all of these disciplines of African studies together under one roof, one concept. And this is what Professor Ajayi had imagined and envisioned. We would ideally like to do so in partnership with a Nigerian university, because such a relationship would give legitimacy to the enterprise. It would establish a level of seriousness and professional and academic responsibility. In my own role as the Vice President of the UNESCO Slave Roots Project, I have spent many years traveling through and across West and Central Africa. What I do know is that the historians and scholars of Africa do not pay enough attention to the African experience outside of Africa. And the scholars of the Americas and the Caribbean do not pay enough attention to African studies on the continent. We are therefore separated and divided. There are very few of us. There are very few of us who are equally proficient in our African studies in Africa and our African studies outside of Africa. This ought not to be. This ought not to be. In the Caribbean, when you are brought liquid at the podium, we would normally ask that a little rum be placed in the water. And you would pour a little libation and then proceed on your way. In this journey, therefore, of African scholars in Africa and African scholars in the Caribbean, we have converged around the concept of global Africa. We have also converged around the concept of reparatory justice as a theme for the future. The issue of reparatory justice emerges out of our history as the most compelling logical step for all of us in the next 10 to 15 years. On our campuses, as these African bones emerge from the ground, our students have said there has to be responsibility for this. There has to be an admission that a crime was committed against our ancestors. There has to be responsibility for this crime, and there has to be reparatory justice for the consequences of these crimes. I have engaged the academic community, the student community, as well as all of our prime ministers on this matter. The conference at Durban in 2001, the United Nations Conference on Race and Xenophobia at Durban, was a very disturbing experience for all of us. The Caribbean delegation arrived and were prepared to discuss with the Europeans the legacy of the crimes of the transatlantic slave trade. We were prepared to discuss with the European governments repairing the damage done to the African peoples, to demand an apology for this crime, and to use diplomacy in order to establish the basis of a movement for reparatory justice. This was a very difficult time for us as Caribbean leaders. I was asked by the governments of the Caribbean to coordinate the Caribbean perspective at Durban. Our African governments did not stand with us. It was painful that as we sought to lay the foundation for a future relationship around reparatory justice, that the government of Nigeria, our largest government, did not stand with us. president of Nigeria, Obasanjo, did say to me, we cannot support the Caribbean in this direction. It was painful. The language at Durban was that something awful had taken place. The Caribbean felt that we have stood by Africa through its difficult years in the struggle for independence in West Africa. Most of our intellectuals migrated to Ghana to support Kwame Nkrumah. We were all over West Africa in support of independence and decolonization. We sent our soldiers into Southern Africa. Thousands of our Cuban citizens died in Southern Africa, driving the apartheid regime out of Angola, Mozambique, Namibia. We raised millions of dollars to support African liberation armies. My own island, Barbados, a Cuban plane on its way to South Africa, because it was known that the Caribbean was the refueling site. We would refuel the Cuban planes to let the planes go across to South Africa. One of those planes was blown up in the air on departing the airport in Barbados. And so we felt in the Caribbean that we have given not only our intellectual energy and support from the days of Marcus Garvey all the way through Ciara James, Sir Arthur Lewis, all the way through to our soldiers in Southern Africa and Zimbabwe. We felt that we had given not only intellectual support, but also we had died and given our lives for African liberation. We therefore were disturbed when, in demanding that the Europeans meet with us to discuss the crimes committed against our people in the Caribbean, that we did not get support. That remains a wound that would not heal. We believe in the Caribbean, that Nigeria especially, but Ghana, Senegal, that they must rise to this occasion and support the Caribbean. The governments of the Caribbean have established an official reparations commission. All 17 governments, of CARICOM unanimously agreed to establish the Caribbean Reparations Commission to not only conduct the public education and research, but to advise the heads of governments on the way forward in this matter. CARICOM has written officially to all of the governments of Western Europe calling for a summit to discuss reparatory justice. That letter has been addressed to all of the prime ministers and presidents of Western Europe, and we are awaiting their responses. We are clear that if diplomacy cannot be the basis of this conversation, we will be left with little choice but to approach the International Court of Justice. But we believe that diplomacy is always the better path to take in dealing with complicated matters of international relations. The governments of Europe are comforted by the fact that the governments of Africa do not support us. They see the Caribbean states as small states on the global stage. And though we can use the floor of the United Nations and all of the other channels available to us, they are comforted that without the support of African governments, the Caribbean search for justice and reparations will not yield results. This is therefore a most critical moment in the history of the African family. We believe, and this is only our belief, that it is the duty and the responsibility of our African governments to support us in this journey. The future of the global African family depends upon it. When I met with the African heads of governments in Durban in 2001, I received three explanations as to why we could not be supported. One, there was a fear that the Federation of Nigeria is fragile, and that to support the call for reparations by the African Americans, the African Caribbeans, and the African Brazilians, that somehow it would engender an internal conversation in Nigeria that would threaten the Federation. The second argument we received was that many leaders in West Africa in the colonial period were collaborators of the slave trade, and therefore our government today have no integrity on the subject. These arguments were refuted by all of us in the caucuses and in the plenary in that United Nations conference. The Europeans have skillfully constructed an argument that there was African collaboration and have used this mythology as the basis to threaten African governments. I have done enough research into West African history to know the truth of that story. If you go through the archives in Britain, in France, in the Netherlands, on the transatlantic slave trade, you will see one compelling truth emerging. Europeans arriving on the coast of West Africa with extraordinary military capacity, confronted small states and gave them an ultimatum. We also know from the archives of Britain, and I have quoted these documents extensively in a recent book I wrote called Britain's Black Debt, where I quoted instructions from the British government to assassinate African kings who did not support the slave trade. And what Europe did was to unleash terrorism across the coast of West Africa. Those letters sent from the British government to the agents in West Africa identifying individual kings and leaders to be assassinated for refusing to comply speaks to the history and the mythology of collaboration. The truth of the matter is, in any case, it is impossible to carry out a global crime without a local collaborator. But the presence of a local collaborator makes the crime even more heinous. The comparison between the narcotics trade and the slave trade are very similar. The narcotics that go into America through Miami and New York can only go through New York to corrupt the young people if there is someone in the port to allow it to come through. But no one says that America is a drug trading nation. No one blames the entire society for the behavior of a few people. You say that there are a few people who are conspiring to endanger their own people. The history of West Africa shows that the vast majority of West African peoples fought against the transatlantic slave trade. They fought against the local assistance, and even a few governments, the people overthrew them if they felt that they were not taking a strong position. And those few leaders who were able to participate and build power around that participation were denigrated by their own citizens. There is no basis, therefore, for any government in West Africa to accept the mythology emerging out of Western Europe that there were participants in this trade. And you must remember that the largest single export of England to West Africa in the 18th century were guns. Unlike the drug trade, guns and slaves went together. If you examine a political map of West Africa in the 17th century and compare that map with the 18th century, the changes that you will see is that most states that fought against the slave trade were destroyed. West Africa was transformed by the power of Western European militarism. We believe that the West African governments have a duty to stand with us on a global scale and to say, this is a matter that has to be discussed. This is a matter that cannot be brushed under the carpet. It was a crime. There has to be responsibility. There has to be consequences. I am currently preparing a monograph entitled 100 Ways to Terrorize Africans in the Caribbean. And I'm cataloging all of the strategies that we use to terrorize the Africans in the Caribbean. Some of these methods were beyond the imagination. The ones you know are the simple ones. The cutting off of the limbs, the cutting off of the head and placing the heads on a pole on the plantations. Most plantations had rows and rows of African heads on the poles, the people who resisted, along the walkway of the plantation were the heads of poles. The boiling the oil, you all know. The placing of Africans in a cage, and you put the cage and you hang the cage from the tree and let the person starve to death and eaten by birds and rats. These are all the standard, but beyond that, there are some extraordinary and creative forms of brutality that were used to keep this system going, to keep this system profitable. Really quite remarkable systems, some of which are not suited for the ears of children. But the most gruesome systems of human torture imaginable under the sun are well documented in the archives of the Caribbean. We have those documents available, but this is a history we are now confronting. Nigeria must rise. The CARICOM Reparations Commission have established a 10-point plan for reparatory justice. In the press of Western Europe, reparations has been given a pretty rough rap. You would read the standard newspaper in Britain, in France, or somewhere, and they would say, well, reparations is about black people standing around on street corners expecting handouts. This is not about handouts. There is no charity that is available to us to compensate for the crimes committed against us. We are speaking about repairing the damage that has been done. In the 10-point plan, the first item is an apology. The governments of Western Europe have all issued statements of regret. A statement of regret and an apology are two very different concepts. We do not wish a statement of regret. We wish an apology. A statement of regret says, I acknowledge that some harm has been done to you. I acknowledge that, the facts are there. I am sorry it happened, but I'm not taking responsibility for it. I'm sorry it happened, but I'm not taking responsibility. An apology says, I have committed a wrong. I acknowledge I have committed a wrong. I apologize to you and the victims and their ancestors who were the subject of this wrong. And critically, we commit that we will never do it again. If the slave trading nations of Europe cannot apologize, what they are saying to you are three things. One, we do not take responsibility for it. Two, you are not deserving of an apology. You are not deserving of an apology. And three, get over it. When Prime Minister Cameron visited Jamaica some 3-4 months ago and spoke in the Jamaican Parliament, this is exactly what he said to the Parliament of Jamaica. Get over it. That statement unleashed massive public anger throughout Jamaican society for several weeks. It forced former Prime Minister P.J. Patterson to issue a statement that Prime Minister Cameron had the audacity to abuse his authority and to abuse the hospitality of the Jamaican Parliament by abusing the Africans of Jamaica. The abuse was particularly striking because Prime Minister Cameron is a logical inheritor of the finances of his slave trading, slave owning ancestors. The Earl of Fife, Prime Minister Cameron's seventh removed grandfather, was one of Jamaica's leading slave owners. He owned many estates, slave plantations in Jamaica, and at emancipation, the Cameron family received thousands of pounds in compensation. That became the basis of Cameron's career today. He became the Prime Minister because his ancestors were able to capitalize on the slave plantations, collect the cash for the slaves who were freed. They bought an estate in the south of England, and they were able to educate their children in the finest schools and finest universities. We pointed out this history to him, and we said to the Prime Minister, here is your history. Here is your past. You are a descendant of the enslavers of these people of Jamaica. You have the responsibility to be generous to these people because your wealth is based on the enslavement of their ancestors. But instead, what he said to the people was, get over it. I had no choice but to describe the distinguished Prime Minister of Great Britain as a racist. I had no choice but to use that language. Because 2 months earlier, his parliament had voted millions of pounds to build a museum in celebration of the Jewish Holocaust. And he had given a statement that the people of Britain must never, ever forget what had happened to the Jewish people. And if he felt that way about the Jewish people, why could he not feel that way about the African people? And I would venture to say to you that Mr. Cameron would not have gone into the parliament in Israel. He would not have gone into the parliament in Israel and tell the Israeli people who had suffered the Holocaust to get over it. So it's a question of what you deserve. And the thinking is that we African people, we are so lowly a people, we are so lowly and debased a people, that we are not deserving of justice. One of the biggest challenges facing the African people in the Caribbean at this time is the ill health of the people. The African people in the Caribbean, if you use the criteria of chronic diseases, hypertension and diabetes, if you use those two criteria, the African people in the Caribbean are the sickest people in the world. Over 65 to 70% of all of the African people in the Caribbean over the age of 60 have hypertension, diabetes, or both. It is not simply a question of lifestyle, as many of the medics in the Western world would say. It's a question of the legacy of slavery. For 400 years, Africans were fed on a diet of sugar and salt. Your daily diet included sugar and salt. That legacy has remained. The African people in the Caribbean, therefore, can no longer effectively metabolize sugar and salt. In fact, what we are working on in our university at the moment is this. If you are an African in the Caribbean and you have high blood pressure, there are three or four medications available to you, produced by the pharmaceuticals. If you take those medications, you have a 70 to 75% chance of a favorable response. Now we know what the medication does when it enters the body. The same drugs, the Caucasians have a 90 to 95% response. Because the drugs are not clinically tried on African Caribbean peoples. We are involved in very expensive biochemical research to adjust these drugs to accommodate the genetic structures of African peoples in the Caribbean. Now, the pharmaceuticals are saying that they will not make the investment because there are only 15 million African people in the Caribbean. And the remarkable thing is that the drugs work on West Africans here as well as they work on Europeans. So here in Nigeria, your response to the drugs is the same as the response of an Englishman. But we, African peoples in the Caribbean, we have a suppressed response because we have been genetically modified by this history of slavery. And so, Caribbean peoples are dying at a faster rate. Caribbean African adults are dying at a faster rate through strokes and heart attacks because of high blood pressure and the ineffectiveness of the drugs that are being used. We have now to adjust those drugs. The pharmaceuticals will not help us. If you in West Africa had this problem, they would spend the money because they say that 500 million African people is a big market. We make the investment, we make a return. In the Caribbean, a small number of Africans, not worth the investment. And so we were dying during slavery, and now we are dying after slavery at a faster rate. Slavery continues. And so we have said reparations, therefore, is about technology transfer to allow us to solve some of these problems. I believe that Professor Ajayi, that his spirit is with us. I believe that I was asked to come here on the 30th anniversary of his visit to the Caribbean to restate his philosophy and his intellectual perspective. I believe that he is saying to us that we must stand in solidarity with each other. I believe he is saying to us that we are one global African family and we must function as a family, and that we must not only talk about it, that we must rise up and demonstrate it. To the Ajayi family, I thank you for the generosity of your invitation. All of us in the Caribbean, at the University of the West Indies, we see him as a prophet. We celebrate him. We celebrate all he has done. And may God bless this republic and all of you gathered here today. I thank you.
Thank you.